Didn't you ever get frightened of the enemy there?
No, I was never frightened. After all, they were all human beings, like me.
But they were shooting at you, Prakash.
Yeah, they were shooting. Because unless the bullet is made for you, you are not hurt. That was always in my mind.
He was the son of a small farmer in the countryside near Lyallpur, in what is now Pakistan. As a boy, he didn't look forward to a lifetime of toil on the land, so he worked hard at school. In those days, the only hope of escape was a job in the civil service, the civil, or a career in the army.
So other boys from a village had joined the army. Whenever they came to the village, they were looking quite smart and quite healthy. So that's what attracted me to join the army. Because firstly, at that time, to get a good service in the civil was a big problem. Even the highest educated people, even the postgraduate people, were just employed as a clerk or something like that. So I said, rather than going to the civil, I must join the army because there is a much discipline and you lead a better life over there. We as a Sikh, we do consider that we are a martial race. So because thinking of our old traditions, after reading of our old tradition like Maharaja Ranjit Singh, who ruled the entire Punjab, even he fought against the Britishers even. He fought three wars against the Britishers and he was a warrior. Even in my childhood, I was a bit aggressive. So I was never frightened from the enemy.
Did you find it exciting, fighting?
I was quite excited when I was given an opportunity to fight against the enemy. I was very much excited.
He was a good soldier, a very good soldier. Always smiling, always ready to laugh. And I think the men respected him.
Prakash's opportunity came when the British launched a campaign in the Arakan Peninsula of Burma.
Our role in the brigade of carriers was to draw fire on the flank to make the Japs think that there was a flank attack coming in, I presume. So we would drive down, fire into them from the flank from our carriers, and we were only armed with Bren guns, and distract them and probably draw fire and draw their attention while the infantry attack went in on the flatter ground.
The first abortive attack went in near the coastal village of Dombike on the 6th of January 1943.
We'd only gone about a couple of miles or so when we were ambushed. We met all kinds. Machine gun fire, mortar fire. We were twisting and turning all around there and I got knocked out. Several other of the crews were injured. And that was that.
So I saw these two carriers fate. They were actually stuck in the mud and they were helpless actually. So I immediately went forward through one side and started operating in between these two carriers and the enemy, which were just advancing towards us. So when they saw this carrier, my carrier, just I was going forward and started circling around. So it was just a bluff to the enemy because I had no ammunition with me. I had only single rifle with 10 rounds left with me. So they thought that I must be having a flamethrower which could burn them. So they immediately went back to their dispositions and in the same time, I gave a signal to these two carriers, chaps, said, you leave the carrier and go back. So they just left their carriers and went back. And I also brought my carrier towards them and picked all of them and came to safety.
We decided that since our role was just to draw enemy fire, we would only send out a driver and one crewman. And the idea was to go down the beach as far as possible and circle around and draw the fire that way. The hope that the firepower that being directed at us wouldn't be directed at the infantry coming, making a frontal attack.
And we did this on the first day of the action, and they fired back at us, of course, and they fired mortars and they fired machine guns and so on. But we were relatively all right. But we got a suspicion, we had a suspicion after the, this action, that they were in fact also firing solid shot.
We saw these shells coming out of the jungle, ricocheting off the beach, and then zooming out to sea, like a big ball of fire. We knew immediately that was an anti-tank gun. Well, a carrier is no proof at all against an anti-tank gun shell. It goes straight through. So it was a bit scary, knowing that if you got a hit, you'd had it.
On the 19th of January, the infantry launched a third attack while the carriers tried to create a diversion.
Well, the battalion was dug in a what we called Sugarloaf Hill, overlooking the Bay of Bengal, which was Donbeg. Now, we were all dug in our foxholes, and you could see clearly what was going on down on the beach.
That you had only a Bren gun armament, which had only been fired through the front aperture when the carrier was facing in that direction. So spinning round and firing when they were in the right position and zigzagging around the beach to avoid fire and coming back in again. Well, in the course of this, although we only had two men, fortunately, in each, two carriers were knocked out.
And, of course, you see the carriers getting hit by the shells. And, of course, naturally, they're going up in flames. Smoke everywhere.
So this was visible from quite a distance. So I immediately took my carrier along with the driver, so with Bren gun in my hand. So we went there to see what is happening there. So when I reached the first carrier, approached the first carrier, I saw a few British soldiers. They were lying in the sea beach over a knee-deep water, and their carrier had caught fire. And the whole ammunition was burning in the carrier itself. And these two, three British soldiers, they were seriously wounded. So I caught hold of them and brought them in my carrier and brought them back to the safety.
So just then, Parkash Singh said, my officer is out there, one of those carriers, can I go out and get him? Well, you couldn't say no to that. And he shouted for his driver, and the two of them jumped into a carrier and out onto the beach.
Parkash Singh had to run the gauntlet of fire down 1,000 yards of beach to the place where his officer was stranded. 40 years later, at Bovington Tank Museum, Bert Causey climbed into a carrier for the first time since that day on the beach in the Arakan.
Well, we were circling around on the beach for a while, and then I felt the terrific bang, and the carrier just sort of shuddered to a halt. When I looked down, there was a gaping hole in front of me, and the boots that I was wearing were all shredded. I thought to myself, oh, gosh. But I couldn't feel anything. But when I turned around to look at my driver, both his legs had been shot off, and there was a hole there where a shell had gone straight through into the side of the carrier there and out in front of me. Well,
what did you do?
Well, for the time being, there was nothing we could do. And then I thought, well, we can't stay here. So I pulled my driver over onto my side and got behind the wheel, hoping that I'd be able to start the carrier again. But when I looked down, there was no clutch pedal. And even if there was, the carrier had jammed in first gear. And I just couldn't get that gear lever into neutral. So there was nothing we could do, only sit there. And all the time, the Japanese were using us as a target. The machine gun bullets were just rattling off the side of the carrier. So all we could do was just keep our heads down and just wait.
And what did you think was going to happen to you?
Well, I think we'd given up hope. I didn't think at the time that anything could be done about it. We'd either be taken prisoner or the Japs would just lob a grenade in and just finish us off.
After coming out of my vehicle, I brought my gun along with me and left it over here, along this carrier, and came forward. And while I was in kneeling position, I was talking to Captain Kaze. I told him to come out, both of you. I have brought a carrier for you.
Well, I heard him shouting at the side, asking, were we all right? And I told him, no, we were both pretty badly wounded, and there was nothing he could do. He'd better get out of it. But he insisted on doing something about it. I said, well, the only way you can get us out of here is by towing us.
I towed one side of the carrier, this carrier, and while I was taking the chain further up to tow my carrier, I looked around towards the enemy side. I saw one section of enemy coming towards me. So I ran back and took my gun. Aimed properly and fired 100 round magazine. With the result, they all disappeared. Probably they were all killed, wounded, or anyway, they went back to their original position. I just kept the gun over here, went further up, towed the chain, and gave signal to my driver to drive the vehicle.
With only one tow chain attached, the carrier veered wildly from one side of the beach to the other. So Parkash Singh had to walk alongside, changing the position of the chain every few yards.
All this was happening under heavy machine gun fire and mortar fire. But their whole object was to get the lads back. They can always replace a carrier, but you can't replace a life.
We were watching all this, couldn't do anything about it. And under continuous fire, and directed his driver, taking a strain on the rope, the tow rope, and then driving out, whereupon he jumped onto the front part, the jutting out part of the carrier, sat cross-legged on it, more or less making rude signs at the Japanese. But he didn't. He just sat there quietly on the front. He didn't get in. An act of extreme bravery, of course.
Well, how many men in the world could say that the rescued wounded men under heavy machine gun and mortar fire, when there's bullets and shells flying all around you? Now, what sort of courage is that?
What made you so confident that you were going to be able to rescue Captain Causey?
Because I had a strong determination in my mind, willpower, and you can say that, well, I was quite confident that I must bring him back. So I did. Succeeded in my mission?
Well, we all got on very well, and my inner skillings and the Rajputs and Punjabis all talked together. I don't know how they all necessarily understood each other, but they'd squat down and chat away together, and they were all very good friends. But there was one thing at which one place the line was drawn. We didn't eat together or drink tea together in the ordinary way. The Sikhs and the Hindus could, but the Punjabi Muslim men and the Christians, we were apart. And our chaps, of course, drink tea from anybody, and they were always making tea anyway. On this particular occasion, the automatic reaction, when the action was over, was let's brew up. And they were very good at this. They carried spare sticks and things in the carriers, light fires. And immediately tea was made. And that was the first and only and last and every occasion I ever saw mugs of tea passed round between Hindus, Mohammedans, and Christians. And it was a salute. And I was in brigade at court for some reason, met the brigadier and said, oh, by the way, you know that recommendation you put in for Parkash Singh? And I said, yes, sir. And he said, well, you probably don't know, but there was another one put in by the gunner, FOO, who saw the whole incident from a bit further back. You probably didn't know this. I said, no. And he said, looking at it all, I was wondering, should I put him forward for a VC? What do you think? So I said, well, it's very difficult to sort of say in cold blood, 10 days afterwards. But I said, I thought about it. And perhaps it would help if I say that the action was taking place and Parkash Singh was doing this, his brilliant act, one of my own men turned to me and said, well, God, there's a fellow winning the VC. So the brigadier said, fair enough, that's it. Go back and get me another half dozen eyewitness accounts, which I did.
I was a soldier, and still a soldier, remain a soldier. So I was always under the impression that if somebody else was in my position, he could also win the same distinction. So I am proud because this is also recognized by everybody, and you got a lot of honor, respect wherever you go with this little piece of medal. So you really feel proud of it when you put on your chest.
The Victoria Cross changed Major Parkash Singh's life.
He became officer also. With that, you see, our way of living and my children after that, everything is changed now. We gave them good education. I mean, with confidence, you see, we were feeling proud with that. Even my children, you see, wherever they go, they always think our father is Victoria Cross holder.
There's one thing we've always learned from him when we were young, that if you want to do something in life and you determine and you have a very strong willpower, there's no such power as you cannot do it. You will get over it and you will do it.
Do you feel that it is a good thing then to have honors for courage in battle?
Yes, it is a good thing. It gives the good incentive to the soldiers. And it is a good example for the others to follow the same path.
The Victoria Cross has brought Parkash Singh honor and respect. It is a lasting reminder of his own moment of glory.
Well, everybody wants to win glory, not me only, if he is given a chance.